Welcome back to Visualizing Volumes. This conclusive video, wrapping up this, I guess you could call it a two-part mini-series, showcases the shell method. And it kind of deserves to be a separate video, because if we look at this from the context or the perspective of a high school AP calculus class, the shell method really doesn't emerge a whole lot, but there are certain instances. It definitely does have its worth, and we'll see why here in just a second. So I think this having its own video is kind of an appropriate split in the content here, but there are definitely cases where shells is far less work than trying to force a washer method of integration to find a volume. So we'll take a look at the how and why here right now. So I think the first important thing to realize is that the shell method stacks its little slices of volume a little bit differently. So we're going to take a look at an animation here real quickly. So here, let's imagine that we've got this portion of a parabola, and it's revolved around an axis like so. And if I'm trying to find that volume, then you can see that the outer and inner radius are the same function, so washers wouldn't really work here without splitting that into multiple functions. So instead, what we do is we stack these little, they're like labels on a soup can that we're stacking. So our, even though the integral, it appears like is what we would want to say is washers stacked vertically, it's actually these labels being stacked horizontally. So it gives us a nice little alternative to the washer method in many cases, or even the disk method in some cases, because it allows us to change the variable of integration to stack in a different way. And again, I'll try to explain that more. It's a little bit easier when I have an example to work from. But visually, that's what we've got going on here. If I just kind of show that again, just watch the different colored labels stacking outward from the center, and that's how we sum up the volume of this solid revolution. We start with these little labels, and you can see that fills up the volume as we stack these kind of concentric cylinders. Okay. So when is this applicable and or necessary? The main reason is like that little visual that I just showed you from GeoGebra. It works wonders when the washer method just doesn't work out or requires an extensive amount of rewriting. Like if we have to split up a function into multiple pieces, work with multiple volumes and adding and subtracting, that ends up being very, very cumbersome, and the washer method really helps us with that. So mainly when our outer radius and inner radius, if we were thinking of the washer method, it's the same function. Those are the cases where we would have to rewrite. So this is where the shell method is definitely better. I hope this makes sense, but another nice benefit of this washer method, I alluded to it earlier, is if we're given information that looks like we want a dy integral, but it's easier, we have easier functions. Easier functions to work with if we had solved for x instead of y. So something like that would be another good indication. If it's easier to stack in one direction than the other, this is another case where washers can be a help to us. All right, so key points with shells, just like with the other methods, we want to visualize the solid that's being formed. How is the revolution happening? We want a firm grasp on what that looks like. Then, again, the analogy is, imagine a soup can that's kind of forming the cylinder at the start, and then we're continuously applying new labels to the outside. Each label is a new lateral area being slapped onto the outside of that soup can, but eventually it's going to expand and fill up a volume. So we're actually going to use the lateral area formula for a cylinder to build up the integral. That's the geometry formula that we're going to be trying to attach our functions to. And again, it's really, really important, because this kind of goes in a different direction than what we're used to. Usually the stacking is something that's very easy to grab from the language. So tying in with visualizing the revolution, think about how the labels are stacking up. the way that they're stacking determines whether it's a dx integral or a dy integral. All right. Now, believe it or not, it seems like it's a challenge, but really the challenge is in the visualization. The actual integral work isn't very difficult at all. So here you can see our first example. We've got a little stray mark there. There we go. And you can see we've got this little portion of a parabola, kind of like our visual. And we can see by the little arrow off to the left of our diagram there that this is being revolved around the x-axis. So let's just imagine, because you look at this and you think about this solid being revolved, you think, oh, this is a washer method, because I've got a little r and a big r, I can just do washers. But how are we defining big R and little r? It's from the same functions, the same curve giving us those. So pretty quickly we'd realize that our integral is not going to work as smoothly as we would hope from a washer perspective. Okay, so maybe let's get a visual for the volume that's happening here. So what's going to happen here is I've got this being revolved around, and this is kind of like the soup can. And then what's going to happen is I'm going to apply another label to the outside of that soup can, and then another label after that, just like those beautifully animated, much better than my hand-drawn attempts here. But by continuously stacking those labels, that's what's going to drive this integral to work more smoothly with one formula instead of splitting it up. So take a look at what's going into each of these soup can labels, right? Each one of them is like a little cylinder, but we're ignoring the circles on the top and bottom. So each one has a height, and notice that height is an x distance. It's an x measurement. And then each one of those cylinders also has a radius, r, and that r value is just the height off of the x-axis. So we'll be able to grab that just with the variable y. Okay, and that's really all we need, because let's think back to geometry here. Lateral area equals 2 pi rh. Really nice that there's no second powers in there or anything like that. We've determined that h is going to have to be an x measurement. So if I look at the original curve that's given, x equals 4 minus the quantity y minus 2 squared. I would simply add the x to one side and subtract that quantity back over. Okay, so r is just going to be the height that we're at as we march our way along the y-axis. See the stacking of those labels? They're stacking vertically, even though the volume that they're filling kind of moves all over the place. So r is going to equal just the y value we're at. H is going to be whatever I get for an output from that function x. So h is really going to be 4 minus y minus 2 squared. And you'll notice that that's a function that uses y as an input. So my integral, I'm stacking the labels along the y-axis. I start at 0, because that's that first point of intersection. We can see the shaded region given to us. That's a pretty nice gift that they provide that graph for us. And then I go up to, I will stop stacking those labels once I get to a height of 4 on the y-axis. And inside, I'm going to have some function of y dy. So you'll notice my integral, the bounds are y values. The function inside uses y as an input. And the differential, those small changes, the stacks are happening in the y direction. So everything's building up quite nicely here. So we've got kind of like a substitution stuff that could take place. So my integral, if I kind of bring in, I want to express that lateral area as a function of y. So how do I turn this 2 pi rh into something with y as an input, have that be the integrand? Well, we've got 2 pi, And we said R is Y, so we'll substitute that in. And then we said that H is 4 minus Y minus 2 squared. So you see the 2 pi R H? We've just taken a geometry formula and merged it with the algebra functions that we're working with right now. Now, there's certainly quite a few different ways we could approach this, but notice we're totally able to do this with a single integral now, and that's what shells provides that washers would not necessarily do. So our usual integration tricks, like freeing a constant multiple, let's free that 2 pi out of there. And then it'd be nice if this were just a polynomial and not a product inside. So while you could possibly work out some type of a U substitution method of calculating this integral, I think when I FOIL everything out and expand everything out, this will actually be pretty manageable. We've got minus y squared minus a negative 4y, and then minus positive 4. And all I'm doing is expanding this y minus 2 to the second power. Cancel out the negative 4s. It's important to train yourself. A lot of times AP calculus students are very good at doing multiple steps in their heads, and this would be a good example of that. We want to be sure and realize that some AP reader, some random person is going to be reading this work. We want it to be not a shadow of a doubt from one step to the next what we did. And that often means when you're canceling things, I would not cancel and distribute in that step in black up above. I would show the cancellation I get when I combine like terms as one step. We're communicating with our math. Now let's distribute. And again, that's just so whoever the AP reader is, regardless of where they come from, math is universal, but I want to make sure that they don't have to try and read between the lines. I want it to be plain as day. All right, and you can see we're actually in a pretty safe place right now. I'm ready to antiderivate. Negative y to the third, that had to come from negative 1/4 y to the fourth power, and then 4 y to the second, that had to come from 4/3 y to the third. We're evaluating that from 0 to 4. Now, I'm really happy that the lower bound is 0 here as well. With polynomials, having zero as one of your bounds is a very, very good thing. So I've got 2 pi, and then let's see, with my upper bound, I've got negative 1/4, and then 4 to the fourth. What would that be? Would that be 256? I think it would. So 4 to the fourth is 2 to the eighth, which is 256, okay? And then plus 4/3 y to the third, 4 to the third is 64. So there's my upper bound plugged in. And when I plug in a 0, subtracting away that lower bound is just subtracting away 0. There's really no need. And now again, in the eyes of the College Board, this would be a sufficient answer, as unsimplified as that is. However, it's always so gratifying to get a nice, clean answer, exact answer at the end, and then to look back and say, this is a really complex-looking solid that has been formed, and I know its exact volume, not having it all sprawled out like this. Let's see, we got the 2 pi out front, negative 1/4 of 256 is 64, and 4/3 of 64 is 256 over 3. That would be 2 pi times, 64 times 3 is 192. Get a common denominator there to combine those together. That's 2 pi times, what would this be? Be 64 over 3. So final answer is 128 over 3 pi. Now, just to elaborate for a moment, if you'll indulge me, if I wanted to set this up as a washer method problem, you can see that really once we got the pieces in place and visualized the shells stacking up, that gave us one integral to find this volume. If I wanted to use the washer method, I would have to make a split. I would have to redefine this function as it stands so that I would be able to stack washers here. Right, and I have to set up a dx integral that goes from x equals 0 to x equals 4, which is doable, I'm not going to lie about that. But notice that when we did that, we only get part of the shape. Then I would have to do a separate washers function just so I wouldn't have an upper and a lower function that cancel each other out. So here we'd have to say y equals 2 is our upper function for the work in black. Then we'd have to go back and add to that a second washers scenario where y equals 2 is the lower function, just so again we don't have the upper and lower canceling each other out. So this one would require two pretty intense integrals. It's doable, but will it be as enjoyable? and the answer there is most assuredly no. But just so you know, like this shells method can often be sidestepped by using washers. It's just a very much more involved process. Let's take a look. I got one more example here. So we've got another example that is just a slice of a parabola. And again, the temptation is to say, ooh, look, we're revolving around the y-axis, so I'm just going to do washers. But again, your inner radius and your outer radius are going to be defined by the same function, so you'd get 0, when clearly this does have some volume to it when we revolve. So as soon as you see that situation, that's kind of the dead giveaway in my eyes that shells is going to be better. So let's see. I'm going to start off revolving this, and then we'll start tacking on some shells as I revolve it around. They'd have a little bit of height here. And the next one, move out here, and I'd add a little bit more height there. And we move out a little bit further, get another shell, and again, hopefully that's kind of like this. I can't think of a better analogy than a lot of labels on a soup can. But I think this visualization is so crucial, and I did notice that I accidentally cropped out the y equals in that problem, so I may want to tuck that in there. We need to see that full function, of course. But what I notice as I look at this is that for each of those cylinders, there's a radius that's an x measurement, and then there's some height, and it's not on an axis. So that might be a little bit interesting. We'll just see how it pans out. We're going with shells, so we'll build off of this 2 pi RH geometry formula to kind of set up our integral, and we know that our soup labels are stacking horizontally. They're stacking along the x-axis. So I want an integral that's going to have some x values for bounds, a function with x as an input, and a dx differential. Okay, so let's see what we can define. Well, r is simply going to be whatever x value I'm at. Where does that next label go? How far away? And then h is going to be kind of an interesting story here. So I'm just going to erase away some of my lovely soup labels just to see a point of intersection there. But as I build my integral, I notice that those x values go from 1 to 5. And again, those are just points of intersection there. But what about the height? The height is going to be the function I'm given, that y value that I'm given, x minus 3 squared minus 5, but that function connects to the x-axis. I need to take away 1 from that height because I don't want the height to go measurement to go all the way to the x-axis. I want it to stop 1 short. It's going to take away 1 less, 1 unit of height taken away. So h is actually given by the function x minus 3 squared minus 6. let's build our integral. So integral with x values of 1 and 5, that's the starting and stopping point. We've got 2 pi times our radius x times our height x minus 3 squared minus 6 dx. It's almost like solving a police case a little bit at the start. You know, we're telling a sketch artist, you know, what we noticed about this function. Well, it did have a radius, it was x, and it did have these starting and stopping x values, and it did have this particular height that the function gave us, but it was one, so there's a lot of little pieces coming together here to make this integral happen, but it's one integral. Little constant multiple rule to help us out, get that 2 pi out of there. And again, I want to be very clear in my steps here that I'm foiling combining like terms. And again, here you could pretty clearly tell that maybe a U substitution would be usable here, or maybe parts even. Boy, would that not be as enjoyable though, as just kind of working with a polynomial. I keep using the word enjoyable, like that's our end goal, but it's calculus, it's all enjoyable. So we've got our polynomial inside. Oh, and it's a treasure. Oh, and I just noticed something. If our heights are going negative, here and I subtract 1 to it, it actually makes a longer length. So thinking about this again, I know it seems like we're wanting to take away 1 away from that height measurement, but the height measurement's already negative. To take away from a negative, I would need to add 1. So let's go ahead and adjust that right now. It's not going to change the difficulty of the problem at all. Still the, oops. That would really irritate me looking back at that. Just 1 plus 5 there is sufficient. There. And I hope we see that. If the height was going in a negative direction, subtracting 1 would only make it more negative. It would increase that height in a downward direction. So in order to take away a little bit of that height, we have to add a positive to take away from that negative height. I hope that makes sense. I'm thoroughly embarrassed by that. All right. Time to antiderivate. And a little perturbed that we don't have a 0 for one of our bounds of this polynomial. It just means we've got more places to plug in, more fun to be had, I guess, is a good way of looking at it. Because apparently we're out for enjoyment here in AP Calculus BC, where it's never a dull day. Let's see, we got to substitute in a 5. So 1/4, 5 to the 4th is 625. Minus 2 times x to the third, that's 250, plus 5 halves times 5 to the second, that's 125 over 2. So there's our upper bound everything substituted in nicely. I guess I'm happy that it's a one that's being substituted in. At least I know one to any non-zero power. I guess even to a zero power is going to be one. So let's see, 2 pi, fun with fractions we've got going on now. And again, realize that the College Board would accept this as a perfectly correct answer on their AP exam. So if you're like, oh man, I worry about common denominator work and stuff happening afterwards, box that one up. Because it's considered the correct answer, just unsimplified, and you would get full credit. All right, but we've got 625 over 4. And we're subtracting 1 over 4, so that would be 624 over 4. We've got negative 250, and we're subtracting negative 2, so that's negative 248. And we've got 125 over 2, subtracting away 5 over 2, so that would be plus 120 over 2. Alright, let's see here what we can do with common denominators without a calculator. 2 pi, first time I've used green, I think, other than drawing the soup can labels. 624 over 4 would be 312 over 2 plus 120 over 2 minus 248. 312 over 2 would be 156 plus 60, that's 120 over 2 minus 248. And where's some real estate? Sneak up here. 2 pi times, I'm at 216 minus 248, which is 2 pi times negative 32. Negative 64 pi is our exact answer. However, realize that because we are talking about a volume of a solid, we would report positive 64 pi as the actual volume that that area could, solid would contain. And reason being for that, why did our answer come out negative? It's because the h that went into our formula was always a function that was, a height output of that function is going to be less than 0. So it was like 2 pi rh, and we know the h is going to be negative. So if that's the case, realize that we're talking about a volume, which is a quantity. I wouldn't say that I have a coffee mug that's negative 16 ounces. We just say it holds 16 ounces, so similar logic there. But hopefully this, again, showcases how the shell method operates, when it's applicable, when is a good time to use it, and why we have it, why we bothered to learn it. To think about doing this problem with the washer method is kind of dizzying. You'd have to have 2 dy integrals and a slew of other issues with your bounds along the way. That would be a very, very difficult process. Doable, but not enjoyable. All right, that does it for this lesson. I hope you've enjoyed it and taken away something. Have a great day.